إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أما بعد فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله تعالى وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. All praise and thanks belong to Allah, the Most High, the Most Merciful, the Most Forgiving. We thank Him and we seek His help and aid and forgiveness and protection from the evil of ourselves and sins that we commit. Indeed, whosoever Allah guides, no one can lead astray, and whosoever Allah misguides, no one can guide. And I bear witness that there is no one worthy of worship except Allah alone, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is His slave and messenger. Indeed, the best of speech is the book of Allah, and the best of guidance is the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the worst of religious matters are those that are innovated, and every religious innovation is a bid'ah, and every bid'ah is misguidance, and every misguidance will be in hellfire. Amma ba'd. The one looking at our conditions today, communally or on the ummah level, will not fail to notice the increased number and intensity of fitnahs that we are facing. The tests and tribulations and temptations that we are going through, whether on the individual level or within the family, or as a community living in a non-Muslim country, or also on the level of the ummah, the space for Islamic practice and commitment to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is shrinking rather than expanding. The disapproval that the religious are met with when they practice their religion the way that Allah has revealed it is increasing rather than decreasing. It is harder to raise a family, to raise your children and having grow up praising and loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of all the temptations and fitna around them. In fact, even just as an individual, as an adult, whether you are a young adult or an older adult, to continue to hold on to Islam with all the fitnas around you, it's getting harder and harder to do. And subhanallah, even at the level of the ummah, as with every year we are hoping that we will see increased unity, increased collaboration, increased strength within the ummah, we see the opposite of all of this. Rather than unity, we see division. Rather than collaboration, we see the ummah countries working against each other. Not with each other against their common enemy, but against each other beside a common enemy. We see rather than the Muslim countries flourishing, they are falling apart. And when you look at all of this, it's easy to become frustrated and disheartened, to lose hope, and to think that it is easier to give up rather than to keep fighting or committing yourself to the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the one noticing all of this may ask themselves, why is this happening? And how can we overcome it? And can we and should we ever lose hope? As to why this is happening, it is by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not mysterious to find out the reason, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us, and His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, that fitan are going to increase, both in number and intensity. He said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لا تقوم الساعة حتى تكثر الفتن أو حتى تظهر الفتن. The day of judgment is not going to come. It's not going to take place until fitan increase. They become more prominent, more abundant. They increase in number. They become more frequent than before, and we will find out why inshallah. But that is a reality that the Prophet ﷺ told us about. Meaning, as you anticipate the day of judgment, and as you're getting closer and closer to it, the fitan are not going to decrease, but they're only going to increase. So this is natural to come, and it's natural to expect. But there is a reason why fitan may increase in one country more than another, in one time more than another. And we have a part to play in it. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just to give you an example, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the fitna of Banu Israel, and the specific fitna where Allah tested them on the Sabbath, where He brought the whales and the fish closer to the shore on a day when they are not supposed to fish. So on the day, on the exact day where they were not supposed to fish or hunt, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made hunting and fishing easiest for them. And of course they failed that test and disobeyed Allah Azza wa Jal, and Allah punished them, as you will find in the Quran. The relevant part here for us in this khutbah is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كَذَلِكَ نَبْلُوهُمْ بِمَا كَانُوا يَفْسُقُونَ. So we test them because of the fisq that they were in, because of their disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you were wondering why that happened to them, why on that particular day, the only day where they're not supposed to go to the ocean and fish, why did it happen on that particular day? Allah tells you, we tested them. Why did that test come? بِمَا كَانُوا يَفْسُقُونَ. Because of their disobedience of Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah had made it so. It's like a law in this world, a universal law, that corruption breeds corruption. Injustice leads to injustice. Sin leads to fasad on the face of this earth. So Muslims and non-Muslims are like, all have a choice. If you increase in sin and disobedience and injustice, your life will be complicated. Not only individually, but also communally and on the ummah level. The more that you disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and stray away and run away from Him and His law and His revelation, the more that you run away from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and His example and His sunnah, the more complicated your life is going to be. Again, on the individual level and the communal level and on the level of the ummah. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it so. Because injustice breeds injustice. And Allah made it also so that when you see injustice, you're not supposed to acquiesce to it. You're not supposed to look the other way. You're not supposed to participate in it, because then you become a culprit in that injustice and a culprit in that corruption. You're supposed to distance yourself from it. And the next step, you're supposed to speak up against it. And if you do not do this, you become a partner in it. Allah Azza wa Jal says, in an ayah, when someone may ask, well, if this is a punishment, why does it sometimes hit the poorest and most vulnerable and not necessarily the richest and the most powerful? Allah Azza wa Jal says, وَاتَّقُوا فِتْنَةً لَا تُصِيبَنَّ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا مِنْكُمْ خَاصَّةً. Do not, or avoid a fitna. Beware of a fitna. Distance yourself from a fitna that when it comes, when it descends, is not going to descend upon only those who are oppressors. But إِنَّ الْعَذَابَ إِذَا وَقَعَ عَمْ. That punishment, when it comes from Allah Azza wa Jal, when people deserve it, it's widespread. It does not distinguish between who has committed and who hasn't, because everybody's supposed to rise. To the level where they say to themselves, first of all, if everybody is lying, I'm not supposed to lie. Not the opposite. If everybody is cheating and lying, I'll join the crowd. So what one's supposed to say, if everybody is away from Allah Azza wa Jal, I'm not going to follow their lead. I'm not going to do what they're doing. Rather than say, I'm going to follow the crowd, since they don't pray, I'm not going to pray. Since they disobey Allah publicly, I'm going to do the same thing. Since they don't care about religion, well, that is my path as well. If you choose this path, even if you're not the leader in it, but if you choose this path, you're culpable, you're responsible, you're guilty. So when the punishment of Allah Azza wa Jal descends, it's not going to distinguish between you and the other oppressor. Everyone becomes responsible in the eyes of Allah Azza wa Jal. So when you consider complications, let's begin with it on the personal level and the individual level, and then move to the ummah. If you see that you are confused, living a life that is anxious, misguided, you don't know where the path is, you don't know how to exit and get relief from your pain and trouble, the first thing that you should consider is, do I have guidance from Allah Azza wa Jal? And if I don't have guidance there, where is the keys to this guidance? And the key to this guidance is taqwa of Allah Azza wa Jal. إِن تَتَّقُوا اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ فُرْقَانًا. If you have taqwa of Allah, Allah will give you a criterion, a thing that will separate and distinguish between right and wrong, between guidance and misguidance, between the right choice and the bad choice, between what to do and what to avoid. So if we like guidance as individuals, if we are in this fitna, if my children are living this fitna, if my spouse are in this fitna, if I'm in it and I cannot extract myself from it, you ask yourself, where is your taqwa? Because if you have taqwa, Allah will save you. If you have taqwa, Allah will make the path clear to you. If you have taqwa, Allah will aid your children and your family. But where is this taqwa? When you hear the command of Allah coming to you, reaches your ears and comes to your heart, do you say yes or do you say no? Do you say yes with your body and heart, or do you say no either with body or heart or both of them? And if you distance yourself from Allah and His mercy, you leave yourself victim to the shaitan, and the shaitan will play with you, and the fitness of the shaitan will become your dearest friend that will inhabit your mind and heart and live in your body and live in your family and with your children. Save yourself from the fitna by obeying Allah Azza wa Jal, by living a reverent life, by whenever you have a chance to obey Allah, you obey Him, and you distance yourself completely from the disobedience of Allah Azza wa Jal. And when you see it, you speak out against it. Then Allah will save you. And on the communal level, if we see that we are being tested, and especially a test that leaves us confused, leaves us fragmented, leaves us fighting with each other, not a test that actually increases our iman and increases our resolve. Because there is a test for the faithful. حَسِبَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَن يُتْرَكُوا أَن يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ. Do those who believe or think or suppose that they will be left to say we believe and then they're not going to be tested? We indeed have tested those who were before them, and they will be tested as well, so that Allah will know who is actually saying the truth and is committed to it and who is playing. So Allah Azza wa Jalla, if you are a person of faith, a person of iman, a person of values, of course you're going to be tested. And that test is, alhamdulillah, expected. And when it comes, you'll know that it's a test because of your iman, because it's going to embolden your iman, strengthen your iman, push you closer to Allah Azza wa Jal. But the other type of test that happens because of our sin only adds to our fragmentation and disunity. Only adds to our discomfort. And here is where we have to ask ourselves, do these tests bring us back to Allah Azza wa Jal? Do we learn from them? That's the purpose of that test. Allah Azza wa Jal's aim is not to punish. Allah Azza wa Jal, yes, wants to purify you from sin, but Allah's aim is not to punish. Allah's aim is to awaken, to revive, to bring you back to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And He does that gently with one test after the other. But subhanallah, on a communal level, and more clearly maybe on the ummah level, we find that we go through one test after the other. And when we first, you know, when we encounter that first test, we think that this is the greatest, the epic. Nothing greater, nothing worse is going to happen. But then few years pass, and we find that the next test is even greater than the one that came before it. Confirming what the Prophet ﷺ said about the fitan, يُرَقِّقُ بَعْضُهَا بَعْضًا. Each fitna makes the one that is before it look simple and light. And so the one that will come even after that will make the one that came before it look simple and light. It's because we haven't learned our lesson from it. We are tested, but we don't come back to Allah Azza wa Jal. We are tested, and yet we continue publicly and privately disobeying Him subhanahu wa ta'ala and disobeying the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we keep going deeper and deeper into disunity and in fragmentation. Politically, Muslim countries are unstable. Economically, they are in hardship. Socially, they are fragmented. And instead of them growing stronger, they're growing weaker. And you look at, what is the lesson that we're not learning? What is the lesson that is not learning? What is Allah Azza wa Jal trying to say to all of us? Those who are ruling us, but also those who are being ruled. What is the lesson? The lesson is that there is so much corruption and it's not enough. It's not enough just to blame those on the top. What happens to us as the masses, as the individuals? Have we risen up to the challenge and say, even though there is corruption, I'm not going to be corrupt. Even though there is masiyah and sin, I'm not going to be corrupt and I'm not going to be sinful. I'm going to be a reformer rather than a corruptor. Have I taken this responsibility and said, I'm going to change myself and I'm going to change my children and I'm going to fight as Allah wants me to fight and as His Prophet ﷺ wants me to resist and I'm going to win bi-idhnillah azza wa jal. If the only person I'm able to guide is myself and my family, that is enough. But I'm going to resist this corruption. Have I actually taken that position or have I surrendered? Have I surrendered to my social media and to my phone and to my TV and to my friends and to life's distractions? Am I living a trivial life? An unimportant life where when I pass and when I go and I meet Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah will tell me, it's as if you did not live. You live to eat, you live to drink, you live to sleep, you live to buy, you live to sell, but you didn't live for anything higher. Is this the life that you are living? That is a life that is not worth living. That is a life that is immersed in fitna. That is a life that cannot save itself, let alone anyone else. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to save us and to save the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه. استغفر الله استغفر الله استغفر الله استغفر الله استغفر الله. الحمد لله رب العالمين حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه. وأصلي وأسلم على رسوله محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. This doesn't only happen to Muslims. وَلَا يَزَالُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا تُصِيبُهُمْ بِمَا صَنَعُوا قَارِعَةً. Allah Azza wa Jal says in the Quran, the non-believers, because of the evil that they commit, are continuously being visited by disasters. If you hear about a hurricane, about an earthquake, about a famine, about this and that, this is part of the corruption that humanity is creating. And these are the reminders that Allah Azza wa Jal is sending both Muslims and non-Muslims. Meaning when we look at this, and we have to be sometimes tactful, but at the same time brave enough that when this happens to non-Muslims and Muslims alike, we have to say, this is a message from the one who had created you. The Allah who had created you is telling you that you're not doing right, and Allah wants to wake you up and bring you back to Him. You ask, how can we save ourselves from fitna, small fitna and big fitna, fitna that is beyond us, that is so overwhelming, and fitna that is simple that we think that we can overcome? Well, how do we exit and leave that fitna? Easily bi-idhnillah azza wa jal. It's easy, but it's difficult if we don't listen. It's difficult if we don't comply. First of all, the cause of all types of fitna is neglecting the commands of Allah. Period. This is it. If you want to close the door of fitna, listen to Allah Azza wa Jal. Be close to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then fitnas will stop, will diminish, will decrease. Or at least you will be strong enough, bright enough, insightful enough to know what to do and what not to do, to be safe from it. Most people, including Muslims nowadays, when the fitna happens, they participate willingly in it, not knowing that they are part of the fitna and part of the problem. They either participate in body or at least participate in tongue, and they become guilty in a fitna that they don't even know that it's a fitna. So and so is wrong, so and so is this, so and so is that. Something that is happening thousands of miles away before we really process it and understand it. We take sides and we fight with each other, and we take these intransigent positions in a fitna that we do not fully comprehend. And subhanAllah, only when it's over, 2, 3, 4, 5 years later, when we realize, oh, this is what was really taking place. This is what actually was happening. But we lack the insight. And that insight only comes from patience and taqwa from Allah Azza wa Jal. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam says, in an authentic hadith, عِبَادَةٌ فِي الْفِتْنَةِ كَهِجْرَةٍ إِلَيْهِ. He says, worshipping Allah during a time of fitna is like migrating to me, meaning to him, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. If you want to, the Prophet is not alive today. And there is no possibility for you or me to migrate to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Like if he is in Medina right now, just to go and see him and be next to him, it's not possible to be next to him sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But he said that if you are living in a time of fitna and you adhere to the worship of Allah azza wa jal, you are a muhajir. And a muhajir to whom? You are a migrant to whom? You are a migrant to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this opportunity is still here. Whenever there is a fitna, like the big fitna that we are living in today, adhere to the worship of Allah Azza wa Jal. You don't have to read the news every day. You can if you wish, but you don't have to read the news every day to gain insight. Read the book of Allah Azza wa Jal. Really read the book of Allah Azza wa Jal. And then when you understand it, then when you hear what is happening on the outside, you'll be able to decipher it very easily. You'll be able to understand who is on the side of who. You'll be able to understand the side of the pious and the side of the impious. But don't be overwhelmed by the fitnas that are happening. We need a compass, and this compass is the book of Allah. This compass is the sunnah and the way of his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Don't distance yourself from it, but if you distance yourself from it, the shaitan is our companion and the companion of our children and spouses and community, which sometimes is clueless as to what to do, and the ummah, which is absolutely clueless as to how to exit this turmoil that we are in. The exit from the fitna is easy. It's what Allah Azza wa Jal has revealed from the beginning. It's the fact that we are not following it enough for it actually to save us. The problem is not in the medicine. It's in the person who's not taking the medicine. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make his book and the sunnah of his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the medicine to our hearts, and the medicine to our families, and the medicine to our community, and the medicine to the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ya Allah, save us from all fitan, that which we know and that which we do not know about. And save the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for all fitan, ya Rabbal Alameen. Ya Allah, we ask you to give the ummah of Muhammad guidance and strength and unity, ya Rabbal Alameen. Ya Allah, save us all from all the fitan, ya arhamar rahimin. Make us of those who when they see evil, they speak out against it and they do not follow it. And commit yourself to what you love, ya rabbal alameen, and distance yourself from what you hate, ya arhamar rahimin. Allah, we ask you that you preserve our children from all fitan, and preserve our families from all fitan, and preserve our community and give its guidance, ya rabbal alameen. And again, to preserve the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, unite them upon your book and the sunnah of your Prophet sallallahu alayhi. Ya Allah, forgive us all of our sins. Ya Allah, grant us a sincere repentance against the sins that had overwhelmed us. Ya Allah, give us strength against our weaknesses. Ya Allah, give us strength against our weaknesses. Ya Allah, give us strength over our weaknesses, ya Rabbal Alameen. Ya Allah, give us the best in this life and in the hereafter. And protect us from all evil in this life and in the hereafter. Allahumma atina fi dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina adhab an-nar. اللهم نسألك الجنة وما قرب إليها من قول وعمل ونعوذ بك من النار وما قرب إليها من قول وعمل ونسألك من خير ما سألك عبدك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم ونعوذ بك من شر ما استعاذك منه عبدك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم اللهم يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك اللهم يا مصرف القلوب صرف قلوبنا على طاعتك اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من الفتن ما ظهر منها وما بطن اللهم نعوذ بك من الفتن ما ظهر منها وما بطن اللهم نعوذ بك من الفتن ما ظهر منها وما بطن يا حي يا قيوم برحمتك نستغيث أصلح لنا شأننا كله ولا تكلنا إلى أنفسنا طرفة عين وأقم الصلاة.
الله أكبر الله أكبر.